euch. Thank you very much for the wonderful time to be here. Enjoying this time in Merida. I decided last moment to talk about something different from what was announced in the program, mainly for the reason that when I sent to the organizers the title and the abstract sometime maybe in August. Since then, I had a couple of occasions to talk about that other topic here in Mexico, and those lectures were even videotaped, so if the original title, if it's something that you find intriguing, you should go to the YouTube channel of Efrain, who videotaped those lectures, and you will be able to learn everything. And I will talk about something else. I will explain how to use some kind of some graded algebra, some homological algebra, to, in particular, among other things, to obtain a new proof of the Lagrangian version formula. I will get to the proof of the Lagrangian version closer to the end of the talk, but just to create some context, so this is very, very classical result. So if you take a formal power series without a constant term and with non-zero coefficient of t, then this formal power series admits a compositional inverse, and the Lagrangian version formula is that result that explicitly computes coefficients of the series inverse to f with respect to composition. It says the coefficient of t to the power n of the compositional inverse is obtained by this funny way. You take the series. Just to make it easier to digest, I use a different variable u. It's just a placeholder. You take the u over f of u. F of u starts with u with non-zero coefficients, so u over f of u is a well-defined power series. You raise it to the power n. You take the coefficient of u to the power n minus 1 and divide it by n. So this is a classical formula. It is there are many different proofs of this formula, but so in the end of this talk, I will convince you that you can use graded algebra to obtain yet another proof of this. Now I'll start with some motivation. I will try to explain how arrived to this sort of proof. And so first of all, when you work in many different contexts, when you work in representation theory, in algebraic geometry, and so on, one very useful tool that has been around from late 1970s is Cajoul duality. And Cajoul duality says, originally, it's sort of classical Cajoul duality, as opposed to some other versions, which I will talk about in a few minutes. It's due to Beilenson, Bernstein, Israel Gelfand, and Sergei Gelfand. It says that if you take a graded associative algebra, which is Cajoul, then there is some theorem you can always prove for such algebra. There is an equivalence of derived categories of complexes of A modules and co-modules over a certain co-algebra, which is usually denoted by this A, people in this business call it A anti-Schrake co-module. So if you have an algebra which is Cajoul, and I will say in a second what this means, then there is a co-algebra that you can construct out of this algebra, so that you can in some way relate modules over A and co-modules over this A anti-Schrake. And relationship is by going to derived categories of bounded complexes of modules. First of all, this A anti-Schrake, this Cajoul dual, one simple way to define it is just to say that it's the Tor from the ground field field to itself. If your algebra is graded and let's say connected, so the degree zero component is the ground field, then it's automatically augmented, so the ground field is it has a trivial module structure, and this the Tor space has a coalgebra structure. And the property of being casual, that property which you really need for this to work, again, it admits many different definitions, but one definition which is very easy to generalize is to say that the homology of the bar construction B of A is concentrated on the diagonal. So for every associative algebra, you can define what is called the bar construction or the bar complex of A, which is a chain complex, which somehow where the differential is built out of the product in A. If your original algebra is graded, then the bar complex, in addition to the homological degree, also has a degree which comes from the grading of A. So you can say that homology is concentrated in diagonal. So the degree coming from A is equal to the homology. So that's in this context probably the simplest possible way to define what casual algebra means. One important example, which was the starting point of this business, is to take A to be the symmetric algebra, the algebra of polynomials, in which case the casual dual coalgebra is the exterior coalgebra, and this somehow is how all this business started. So from the paper of Bill and Son and independently Bernstein, Gelfand, and Gelfand, who related studying coherent sheaves on projective spaces to questions about exterior algebra. On this previous slide, everything only works when your algebra is casual. So somehow it is a meaningful and important question from this viewpoint is how to test whether an algebra is casual or not. And there are basically two very general results which are very often used in this business. So first of all, there is a very useful test that can often tell you immediately that your algebra is not casual, which is on the one hand disappointing, on the other hand might mean that some other interesting phenomenon happens. So there is what people often call the numerical test, and this is based on a result of Bakelin that says that for a casual algebra, the generating series for dimensions of components of A is a multiplicative inverse for the same of A anti-shake. So the only thing that I need to mention here, this equation looks slightly different from what you often see in the literature. In the literature, they often put minus T for the casual dual. The thing is that when you formulate it in the language of algebras and coalgebras, you automatically build some homological degrees inside coalgebras. And in your generating series, you take not the generating series for dimensions, but the generating series for Euler characteristics. And so all the signs are hidden over there, and the equation becomes slightly more nice. But in any case, so sometimes you have your algebra, you compute its casual dual, you compute those power series, you see that the product is not equal to one, so it's not casual, and that's that. So that's one very general result. And there is a result that often helps to prove that an algebra is casual, and this uses non-commutative Grobner bases. It says that an algebra which admits a quadratic Grobner basis of relations is necessarily casual. And this, formulated this way, this result, I believe, is due to Fnarovsky, and this is, in some sense, is a reformulation of a criterion of casualness due to Priddy from 1970, way before casual duality as such. Priddy's motivation was coming from algebraic topology and dealing with Steenrod algebra. And unfortunately, there are some algebras that defeat those tests, so neither of these tests is a conclusive criterion. So it is possible to have a non-casual algebra for which the functional equation holds, or a casual algebra that doesn't admit a Grobner basis of relations. So these are useful tests, but they are not necessarily conclusive. So that's somehow what has been known already maybe some 20, 25 years ago, these tests, the counterexamples and so on. However, my intuition and my interest comes from a slightly different corner of this business. It comes from homotopical algebra for operads. And for operads, you do very similar things for somewhat similar purpose. So as I was saying, casual duality for algebras relates you to categories of modules, well, two derived categories of modules. But sometimes you have to deal with categories which are a little bit more complicated than categories of modules, categories, very natural categories which are not abelian. So for example, the category of all associative algebras, so category of algebras of some type. Casual duality for operads tells you how to sometimes prove similar results when you work with non-abelian categories. So what do you do in this case? Suppose, and I will decipher these words in a few minutes. Suppose you take an operad P, which controls algebras of some type, and you want to study the homotopy category of P algebras. Then it turns out that if the operad P is casual, then there is an equivalence of homotopy categories of differential graded P algebras and differential graded P anti-Schrieck algebras, where P anti-Schrieck is some sort of casual dual co-operad, and the property of being casual means that the homology of the bar construction is concentrated on the diagonal. So this part you don't need to change. You really have two different gradings on the bar construction, and you can define casualness in the exact same way. And somehow, historically, the most important example that was motivating Ginzburg, Kapranov, Gessler, Jones, and others when they were working on that in mid-90s is when your operad is the operad of Lie algebras, and then the casual dual co-operad is the co-operad that controls co-commutative co-algebras. So there is this kind, some sort of duality between Lie algebras and co-commutative co-algebras. And somehow the fact that some sort of relationship like that must exist has been clear for many years before casual duality for operads was developed, because there were two different approaches to rational homotopy theory due to Quillen and to Sullivan, and one uses co-commutative co-algebras, the other uses Lie algebras. So somehow the fact that some sort of relationship like that must exist was implicit from that. And now I'm getting very close to my motivation in this story. Similarly to how you can test casualness for algebras, there are also two tests of casualness for operads. There is a numerical test, and numerical test is based on a similar functional equation, but it just, in the case of algebras, the two formal power series were multiplicative inverses of each other. And in the case of operads, the two generating series are compositional inverse from each other. So if an operad is casual, then the generating series for P and the generating series for the casual dual are compositional inverse to each other. Casualness can be proved using Grobner basis, and that somehow is a part of the story where I was able to contribute. So somehow, together with my collaborator Anton Khoroshkin, some seven or eight years ago, we figured out how to define Grobner bases for operads and use them for homotopical algebra. Since then, a lot of people have been asking me, what about how conclusive these tests are? It was obvious that it shouldn't be that different from the case of algebras, and there should be some counterexamples, but no one knew any clean way or any way to that matter to construct such counterexamples. I had for some years a plan of how to construct counterexamples, and then when I started implementing that, I realized that it leads to some interesting constructions, constructions of their own merit, which somehow have some other consequence, and that is what I'm going to tell you for the rest of this talk. So first, now let me give you some definitions, because I was saying the word opera.
So you have this notion of homotopy, and so these things commute kind of up to some homotopy operation. So shouldn't that equation there for the Kosul, shouldn't that be some up to homotopy?
No. The thing is that, as I said, those generating series are generating series for Euler characteristics. So they don't sense the homotopy. It's a homological invariant. Until now, I kept saying the word operad as if everyone should be very sure what it is. And let me tell you what you should think of operads for the purpose of this talk. In fact, in this talk, I will be only working in a very simple context. I will only be talking about non-symmetric operads. So that simplifies things quite a bit. In general, when you have multilinear operations of some kind, in principle, you can do two things. You can substitute operations into one another. So if you take an operation alpha with n arguments and an operation beta with m arguments, you can pick one of the slots of the operation alpha and substitute the operation beta into that slot. So that is one obvious thing that you can do given two multilinear operations. And, of course, you can also permute arguments of an operation. So, a priori, this is what we are allowed to do with nonlinear operations. Sometimes, in general, when you define an operad, you just axiomatize this thing. You say that an operad is a collection of vector spaces indexed by positive integers, where you think of the nth vector space as a space of n linear operations, which have these structure maps circle I, which no longer are necessarily compositions, just structure maps of an operad. And you have the right action of symmetric groups on these spaces, and these compositions of compositions circle I must be, first of all, must satisfy some sort of reasonable associativity of composition, and they should be reasonably equivariant with respect to the symmetric group action. And in fact, when you try to write it carefully in these terms, you end up with a rather messy collection of axioms that can be written a cleaner way, but sometimes things can be simplified drastically, and you can completely ignore the matter of symmetric group actions in the following situation. So, for example, when we work with associative algebras, those are algebras, well, satisfying this identity. So, because arguments A, B, and C appear in the same order, I can just erase A, B, and C and replace them by these dashes, and this absolutely it encodes associativity in an absolutely faithful way. I don't really need to remember the names of the arguments, because it would be important if, for example, here I had C times B. Then if I erase names of the arguments, I lose some information. But if arguments appear or in exact same places in all the terms, I don't lose any information when I just erase the things. This is precisely the associative algebras, give an example of algebras over an operad that comes from a non-symmetric operad, where in the defining properties of the structure operations, all arguments appear in the same order. So this, so if the structural operations have no symmetries and the defining properties have no symmetries, so everything, all arguments always appear in the same order, we can just forget about names of the operations and forget about action of permutations and always write everything where arguments appear in the same standard order. I want to emphasize that it is important that not only that also in the very beginning, when the general associative product has no symmetries. So, for example, if we work with Lie algebras, we know that the bracket of A and B is equal to minus the bracket of B and A, and so there is this kind of ambiguity. We don't really, because of this symmetry of the operation, we don't really know what is the standard order of arguments, because things can be written in many different ways. So when I'm talking about non-symmetric operads, I mean really that I start with operations that have no symmetries, and in all the defining relations, arguments appear in the same order. So this is the context. And in this case, it is very easy to define what an operad is in such a way that you can actually do something with this definition. This is the definition. So a non-symmetric operad, so it's a collection of vector spaces P of n for all positive integers n. And these spaces you should think of as spaces of operations, of n operations of some type. Then there are these structure maps, circle I, P of n tensor P of m to P m plus n minus 1, which implicitly you should be thinking of insertion of an operation with n arguments into the ith slot of an operation with m arguments. And there are two axioms that these things should satisfy. So let me explain what these axioms mean, because when they are written like that, it can be a little bit confusing. But basically, when you substitute operations with several arguments into one another, so you have, for example, situations like that, right? So you take an operation here with four arguments, you substitute something in its first slot and in some other slot. And you can do it in two different orders. And the results, of course, are exactly the same. And this is this first axiom. This means precisely that, and this is called the parallel axiom in an opera. That if you do compositions which are parallel, which don't really interact, then the results of in two different orders are the same. And there is the second axiom, which is called the sequential axiom. And that axiom reflects something like this. So you can do a substitution like that, and then considering this as an operation of its own merit, substitute something in one of the slots here. Alternatively, you can first do this substitution and then substitute this composite operation into the thing that you started from the beginning. And this also are equal when we are talking about actual multilinear operations. And so this you should take as an axiom if you want to axiomatize a substitution of multilinear maps. And this is somehow maybe more close to associativity. If you deal with unary operations, if you deal with operations with one input and one output, that one is exactly associativity, and this one doesn't exist because for parallel property you need at least two different slots. So when you deal with unary operations, when you deal with linear maps, you only see the second axiom, and with when RT goes up, you have both of these properties present. And also, similarly to how we can talk about unital and non-unital algebras, you can talk about unital and non-unital operads. So if you think of operads as not linear operations of some sort, then there is a very important distinguished linear map, just the identity map that sends every element to itself. And this plays the role of the unit, and this should satisfy some properties. Basically, substitution of the unit in any slot doesn't do anything, things like that. One important thing that I want to mention still on this slide, where we have all these axioms, that if we forget all the product circle I for I greater than 1, if we only do substitutions in the first slot, then this collection of vector spaces becomes a graded algebra. Well, I mean, I write weight graded, and I will be repeating the word weight on many occasions, because in topics that I am talking about, it is often the case that there are many different gradings. In particular, very often you have the homological grading, because you work with chain complexes, and separately some sort of other grading. And the difference between homological gradings and weight gradings is that weight gradings are used to somehow split things just into a direct sum of smaller things, and homological grading actually creates some signs, create by casual sign rules. So homological grading, usually you have to watch it a little bit more carefully so that your formulas don't get messed up. But in any case, so this is just a weight grading. So if you look at this sequential axiom and put I equal to k equal to 1, then it just becomes the associativity, which is clear if you draw the corresponding picture. And if you say that the weight of RT, of any operation of RTn is equal to n minus 1, then those weights add, because well, n minus 1 plus m minus 1 is m plus n minus 2. So everything works nicely. Okay, so that was a crash course on non-symmetric operads. Now let me try to explain how to use all this. So I just said that, so if we forget everything except for substitutions in the first slot, we get a weight-graded algebra. So notationally, so let me just introduce these operations where I shift degrees up and down, because on the previous slide I need to subtract one so to obtain an honest weight grading. And it turns out that that what I said can be said in this fancy way, that you have a functor from DG operads to weight graded DG algebras, and so where you do the essentially what you do is you do this shift up and forget about the substitutions in all other slots except for the first slot. For all the other constructions that I will be discussing in this talk, I will be using I will sometimes need my algebras and operads to be augmented, but in fact I will be using connected algebras and operads. Well, a connected graded algebra is an algebra where in degree zero you have the ground field. Similarly, a connected operad is an operad where in RT1 you just have the ground field, so the unit, and nothing else in RT1. I will define now two different ways to somehow revert the construction that I just explained. So I explained that if you have a non-symmetric operad, you can obtain a graded algebra from it. And I want somehow to go back to construct operads out of algebras. And there are two rather trivial ways to try and revert this construction. One is to do something like this. So there is this little technicality that you take the augmentation ideal, but modular this technicality, what you say, you just take your graded algebra, you shift the degrees, because previously you were shifting them up, now you have to shift them down, and you just impose the relations that the compositions in the first slot is equal to the product of the algebra, relations that you somehow already know from before, and don't impose any other relations. Or alternatively, you can say that you impose the relations that the composition in the first slot is equal to the product of the algebra, and all other compositions are equal to zero. So somehow just make it very small, so only retain compositions in the first slot. And so I call these two operads the max envelope and the min envelope of the graded associative algebra A. And so now my goal is to convince you that these envelope operads satisfy some nice properties that make them in some way useful. So first of all, the min envelope operad is actually just the right inverse of the functor that makes algebras out of operads. And this is somehow very simple. So you take an operad, you take an algebra, shift degrees, you impose the conditions that the product, that the composition in the first slot is equal to the product and all other compositions equal to zero, and then you go back and forget about all other compositions. But since we impose the relations that compositions in all other slots are equal to zero, there is really nothing to forget. It is very easy to see that if you go there and back, you get your original algebra. You don't get anything extra. A more interesting result is that if you take the max envelope, it actually is the left adjoint to the functor that makes algebras out of operads. So you have a functor A that forgets all the compositions except the compositions in the first slot. You have the max envelope that builds this big operad where and these two functors are adjoint, and in fact, what is very important for purposes of homotopical algebra, this adjunction is a Quillen adjunction for the standard model category structures on these categories, which means essentially for in simple, in naive terms, it's the sort of adjunction that induces an adjunction of the corresponding homotopy categories. So it behaves well with respect to localizing quasi-isomorphisms. What is even more pleasant, maybe, is that these functors behave very well with respect to bar-co-bar constructions. So similarly how for operads, for algebras, you have the bar construction of an algebra, which is a co-algebra, the bar construction of, co-bar construction of a co-algebra, which is an algebra, and there is some adjunction. There is something like that for operands, and the following result holds. So if you take A, which is a graded associative algebra, you can do two things. You can do many things. You can take the bar construction of the max enveloping operand, the bar construction of mean enveloping operands. And also, you can take the bar construction of your algebra, which is a co-algebra, and take the corresponding co-operadic mean and max envelope. And it turns out that the bar construction of the max envelope is quasi-isomorphic to the mean envelope of the bar complex. Bar construction of the mean envelope is quasi-isomorphic to the max envelope of the bar complex. It is important that these are quasi-isomorphisms, so they induce isomorphism on the level of homology, but in general, they are not... first of them is a quasi-isomorphism, second is an honest isomorphism, in fact. So somehow that's the story here. And now you can we can remember that bar complexes can be used to for purposes of casual duality. The property of being casual means that the homology of the bar complex is concentrated on the diagonal. We can take these formulas, take the homology, and see what this implies for the casual duality. And what we see is the following result. So suppose that we have an algebra A, which is quadratic, and its casual dual is the algebra antitrig. So then, first of all, both the mean envelope and the max envelope are quadratic operands. Then the mean and max envelopes are also interchanged by the casual duality. The casual dual of the mean envelope is the max envelope of the casual dual coalgebra. The casual dual of the max envelope is the mean envelope of the casual dual coalgebra. And most importantly, that these operands, the mean envelope and the max envelope, are casual if and only if the original algebra is casual. And this is an amazing situation. This is quite a miracle, because there are several different constructions that build operands out of associative algebras. Most of these constructions, however beautiful they may be, they don't possess remarkable homotopical properties. They don't preserve the property of being casual, at least there is no if and only if statement. There is there are results that say that if an algebra is casual and an operand is casual, if the other way around, it's almost impossible to hope for something like that. And in this case, it holds. And this is really wonderful and surprisingly in the context of the in this context also surprisingly easy to prove. Not only it is true, but also the definitions are designed in such a way that actually it is quite easy to prove this. Now, let me discuss applications. So application number one: there exists a casual operand P1 and the non-casual operand P2 such that the generating functions for dimensions of components are the same for P1 and P2, and the generating functions for electric characteristics of components are the same for casual dual as well. This, of course, means that you have no chance to test casualness with a numerical test, because whenever you have a casual operat P, then the generating series are inverse to each other. And here, well, the for P2, it also will be forced, even though P2 is not casual. So the numerical test is non-conclusive. And there exists a quadratic casual operat P, which essentially doesn't, for which it is not possible to find a Grobner basis of relations, regardless of how you choose a basis in the space of generators, how you choose an order of monomials. There is absolutely no way to do that. And so the Grobner basis test of casualness also is inconclusive. And I want to say that these theorems, they are super nice, and but again, they are also within my formalism. They are quite easy to prove because they just convert examples for algebras into valid examples for operads, precisely because the functors I constructed preserve the property of being casual. So somehow these theorems, sound super nice and beautiful, but the most, in some sense, the most striking part of these theorems, of these formulations as such, is due to Berger, Pestselsky, Pankowski, and others who constructed similar things for the case of algebras. And in these two theorems, my contribution is inventing this way to automatically convert results for algebras into results for operads. And now let me go back to proving the Lagrange inversion formula as I promised in the beginning. So I remind you what this formula is. And basically the key result that I am going to prove is the following thing, that I am going to prove that the generating function for that for coefficients of the for dimensions of components of the max enveloping operad of an algebra B, you have this formula that the nth component of the max envelope, its dimension is equal to 1 over n times the dimension of n minus first component of the nth tensor power of B. So this is the this is the key result I'm going to explain to you now, and then I will use that to convert this formula into a proof of Lagrange inversion. So this is the, I just copied this formula here. So first, the first step is that using Grobner basis for operads, I can present a very nice basis of the max envelope. In general, when you work with operads, when you work with associative algebras presented as quotients of free algebras, then you usually find the basis of monomials, of words. When you work with operads, you find the basis of trees with some decorations. And for the max envelope, it turns out that you should take trees where you do not allow substitutions in the very first slot. So trees like this, maybe. So the you never do substitutions in the first slot, in the first leaf in the leftmost child of every vertex of a tree. And then there is a simple combinatorial rule that takes such a tree, so these trees are also indexed by some elements of of your algebra. And then you every such a tree can be converted into a word. So basically, for every I, we look at the leaf number I, and we say, and we look if it is the leftmost input of its parent vertex or not. And if it is the leftmost input, you put the you write down the label of that parent vertex, which is labeled by elements of your algebra. And if it is not the leftmost input, you just write the element 1 of the algebra. So, for example, this tree that I drew here, it has what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 leaves. So to this tree, we should associate a tensor in b to the tensor power 7. And this will be done in the following way. We take the first leaf. It is the leftmost leaf of its vertex. And so we write the label of its vertex, A1. We take the second leaf. It is the leftmost leaf of its parent vertex. So you write the label of this vertex, A2. You take the third one, A3. You take the fourth one, which is not the leftmost leaf. And so you write 1. You take the fifth one, which is the leftmost leaf. So you write A4. You take the sixth one, which is not the leftmost, you write 1. And you take the seventh, which is not the leftmost, you write 1. So this is the rule. How to obtain if you take a tree with n leaves, out of it you construct an element from b to the tensor power n. So that's what you do. And somehow the elements that you get here, there is some constraints on because of the way we relate arity of elements in operad and degrees of elements in algebra. There are some constraints on the degrees of the elements that you get here, and somehow this constraint. So it turns out that there is a classical combinatorial result, which is called Reydy's lemma, that every word where the total degree is equal to n minus 1, and remember that degree is equal to arity minus 1. That's how we convert operads to algebras. There exists a unique cyclic shift for which all these inequalities hold. So somehow that's why you have to divide by n. So that's how you should view this formula. So on the left-hand side of this formula, you have you are enumerating all trees where you don't substitute in the first slot of the operation. On the right-hand side, you enumerate tensors of length n, but satisfying some constraints. And instead of satisfying constraints, you can take, you can look at all tensors, look at all cyclic shifts of each tensor, and pick out of them the unique ones satisfying these constraints. So that's the way you should be thinking about this formula. Now, finally, how to use this formula. I take it and I apply this to the bar complex of A. And then I have I have this formula. So this is the formula I started with. So the generating function for the nth tensor power is the nth power of the generating function, because generating functions multiply when you behave well with respect to tensor products. Moreover, we know that the max envelope of the bar complex is quasi-isomorphic to the bar complex of the min envelope. And for operads, It is a general result which follows from the Barker-Baron adjunction that the generating series for the bar complex is the compositional inverse for the generating series of the operad. So this last equation is true for any operad at all. You don't need any assumptions whatsoever. And on the right-hand side, the generating function of the bar complex is the multiplicative inverse of the generating series of the algebra in the case of algebra, because of the Barker-Baron adjunction for algebras. And so, and now the only thing that you need to see is that the generating series for algebra and the generating series for operad are differ from one another. That you need to multiply one by u to account for the degree shift. And so, u over the generating function of the mean envelope to the power n, n minus first coefficient divided by n, is equal to the nth coefficient of the generating function of the nth coefficient of the compositional inverse for the mean envelope. So this shows that the Lagrange inversion formula holds when your power series f of u is the generating series for the mean envelope of some algebra. And now you can this means that you proved, in particular, you clearly proved the Lagrange inversion formula for all power series whose coefficients are non-negative integers, because every power series whose coefficients are non-negative integers is generating series for some algebra, for example, the great algebra where with zero multiplication. And then, of course, it is enough to conclude that this formula holds for any power series, because the coefficients of the inverse series are polynomial expressions in the coefficients of the original series. So it's enough to prove everything at integer points. And this somehow completes the proof. All right, I'll stop here and thank you for your patience.